worthy of being together so we can share together, fellowship together, and be trained together as we move forward in the great work you've committed into our hands. We pray, Lord, that none of us will be fruitless in Jesus' name. We pray, Lord, that all the help we need, you give unto us so that this work will prosper in our hands. Lord, cancel barrenness spiritually. Cancel barrenness in our families. We pray, Lord, we'll be rejoicing in the fruitfulness of your work in our hands in Jesus' name. Bless us together tonight. No exception. In Jesus' name we pray. God has blessed you already. We're looking at Proverbs chapter 18, and I'm reading from verse 24. Proverbs chapter 18, verse 24. A man that has friends must show himself friendly. And there is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. Tonight we're looking at various areas and various aspects of friendship. Actually, as you look at that verse, it says, a man that has friends, other people are friendly to him. That man himself must show himself friendly. That means friendship is not one-sided. Others are your friends, and also you are friends of them. And it says there is a friend that sticks closer than a brother, than a relative. There are times when you might have some crisis, have some problems, have some challenges. And the people you think, this is a brother, this is a sister, that is of the same parents, they're nowhere to be found. But it's a friend that actually comes and it sticks close, closer than a brother. This kind of friendship is something you cultivate. It's not something that just happens. I just find that he's my friend. I just discovered I'm his friend. No. You have to cultivate such friendship. So tonight I'm talking to you on cultivating true friendship and reaping its benefits. Cultivating true friendship and reaping the benefits of that friendship you cultivate. No man is an island by himself. Isolation makes man lonely and unhealthy. Association, on the other hand, which is the opposite of that isolation, makes us lovely, makes us lively, makes us happy, makes us healthy. Yet, true friendship must be purposefully nurtured to be of real benefit to man. Faithful friends are few, false friends are many. The many people that might say, I'm a friend, I like him, I love him, I like her, I love her. Maybe you have something to give them. Maybe because you're rich. There are many people that are friends of the rich, but the poor is cast away, separated from them. There are casual friends. The people, they're so casual. There's nothing that comes from them. There's nothing that flows to you from them, but they're casual friends. There are constant friends that no matter the time, no matter the situation, you always find them there, constant. There are confirmed friends, and you have confirmed with a testimony. You have confirmed that I had such a challenge like that, he was there. And then I was facing that, he was there. And you have confirmed by their action. You have confirmed by their helping hand. You have confirmed by their association at the time you need them, the true friends. There are conscientious friends. It's like they work at it. It's like they take you as a project almost. And they have plans for you. and they have a place they want to take you, and they believe that with their friendship you should become a better person, that gets something higher and greater than you would have got all by yourself alone. They are conscientious. Others are just constant, always there. They continue and continue and continue. And you can count the years we've been together since this time, and he has been friendly, she has been friendly since that time. Casual, that's not the kind of friend you need, but committed friends, but confirmed friends, conscientious friends, constant, consecrated friends. There are bad friends though, and they influence our lives negatively, and they inflict much suffering on our lives because they are bad, because they are sinful, because they are terribly evil. They inflict suffering on us here on earth, and with terrible pain and agony on the other side of the grave, in hell, all through eternity. Good friends are beneficial now on earth, and these good friends may assist us to have everlasting, eternal happiness in heaven. Once again, remember, friendship, good friendship, profitable friendship, practical friendship is something you cultivate. You don't leave it like, you know, it's like you have a farm, you have a garden. If you leave it there without any cultivation, bad weeds will grow up. And the same thing with friendship. If you leave it like that untouched, not nurtured, not cultivated, some bad things will come in. But you cultivate good friendship. Come back to that Proverbs again, chapter 18, verse 24. A man that has friends must show himself friendly. And there is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. We're coming to Mark chapter 5. Mark chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 15. Mark chapter 5, reading from verse 15. Here we're told in verse 15, Mark chapter 5, and they come to Jesus and see him that was possessed with the devil, and had the legion sitting and clothed and with his right mind. And they were afraid. This man had been tormented by evil spirits, legions of them, thousands of them. And he had suffered in a way that nobody could help him, if you read the whole story. And then he came across Christ, and Christ delivered him. That's always what Christ does. When you come across Christ, you encounter Christ, he will deliver you. He must deliver you. And no trace of the problem of the past will remain in Jesus' name. And it says, they that saw it told them how it befell to him that was possessed with the devil, and also concerning the swine. You remember that story? I said, do you remember that story? The swine perished, but the Lord saved his life. And they began to pray him, to urge him to depart out of their coasts. Verse 18, and when he was come into the ship, he that had been possessed with the devil prayed him, pleaded with him that he might go or be with him. Howbeit Jesus suffered him not, but says unto him, go home to thy friends. You have to do something, you know, to your friends. You're healed, tell your friends. After all, that's why they're friends. When you're happy, you don't keep the happiness to yourself. Tell your friends. You're prospered, you don't keep the prosperity to yourself. Tell your friends. You're saved. You don't keep that salvation to yourself. Tell your friends, there's something that has happened in your life. This is a breakthrough. This is a great manifestation of God's love and sympathy for you. Don't keep that to yourself. Tell your friends. And you see this man, he had been delivered. And the deliverance was spectacular, was great. And here is what the Lord said. Jesus will not allow him to just separate himself. I'm a Christian now, I'm born again now. I'm saved, I'm delivered, I'm set free now. I'm going to be with Jesus. How about all those your friends who are in ignorance? Well, I don't know about them. I'm just happy. I'm going with the Lord. Jesus suffered him not. But he says unto him, go home to thy friends and tell them how great things the Lord has done for thee and has had compassion on thee. And he departed and began to publish in Decapolis how great things Jesus had done for him, and all men did marvel. Actually, the man took that almost like a full-time job. He didn't have any other thing he was doing. Look at this. I was mental. I was deranged. I was a lunatic. I was oppressed. I even wanted to hurt myself. I was in the tomb. I was everywhere. And I wasn't doing anything useful, profitable, practical at that time. The rest of my life, all my days now, I'm going to keep on telling my friends, like Jesus has said, how great thing he has done for me. And he told them, and the people did marvel. Come to Acts of the Apostles, chapter 10. Acts chapter 10. There is this man, Cornelius. He had been praying, and the Lord now sent an angel. And the angel came and said, Cornelius, the Lord has answered your prayer, but now you need to do something. Send to Joppa, and then call for one Simon Peter. He will come and tell you how you'll be saved, fully saved, completely saved and redeemed. And so he sent to Joppa. While he was expecting Peter to come, look at Acts chapter 10, verse 24. And the morrow, after they entered into Caesarea, verse 24, and it says, and Cornelius waited for them, and had called together his kinsmen, tell me, and their friends. He called them together. I'm expecting something good come. You must be part of this. I'm expecting, you know, a messenger, a preacher of the gospel is going to tell me good news. You must hear this come. And then he went around. Isn't that what you ought to do? That all our neighbors, all the people around us, as we see that we're getting something great, something good, you're coming for next Thursday revival hour. Am I right? And you are coming with great expectation. God has been doing some wonderful things, and I pray that this river of revival and river of miracle that is a flow in the stream, it must flow to you. Yeah. I said it must flow to you. Yeah. You know, some people say, I'm not sick, and so I don't know whether I want to come or not. There's something that God is going to impart into your life. Sickness or no sickness, a miracle will come your way. Yeah. But you see, as you're coming, you'll do like Cornelius did. He got all his neighbors and he got all his friends. And he says, something great is coming. Something wonderful is coming. You must be part of this. And so he gathered them together. And isn't it wonderful? You're also coming next Sunday. You're coming on Sunday. You're coming on. It's like the whole of this coming week from tomorrow is just made for you. And tell me how you can escape the blessing of God. The blessing of God as you are coming on the way, before you even get to the central church, Bagada church, a miracle is already following after you. And so tomorrow it's there, and Thursday is there. And you know, I promise you, I'll be waiting for you. What are you? You'll be there in Jesus' name. But you know what Cornelius did? He called his friends and got his friends, and they all came. Look at verse 33. In verse 33, it says, immediately therefore, he was talking to Peter, now Cornelius, I sent to thee and thou hast well done that thou art come. Now therefore are we all here, myself, my family, my acquaintances, and all my friends, now are we all here present before God to hear all things that are commanded thee of God. Look at verse 44. And while Peter yet spake, he had not finished. While Peter yet spake, that's what I told you is coming upon your life. And while Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell on all them, his acquaintances, his friends, his neighbors, all the people that gathered together. The Holy Ghost fell on all them that heard the word. And they of the circumcision were beheld, were astonished, they were surprised. It was a marvelous thing to them. As many as came with Peter. Look at Peter. When he came, he had friends and companions too. And he came with them. You see, there are people, they ride their cars alone to the meeting. They don't come with anybody. And there are soul winners, they go to win their souls all alone by themselves. They don't go with anybody. They don't have any friend. They don't have any companion. And they don't have anybody they can take along and say, well, let's go together. We're going to reap the harvest together. And we're going to reap the reward together in Jesus' name. And Peter, it says, and Peter, and those that were with him, it says, because that on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. And they had them speak with tongues. If that has not happened to you, it's going to happen to you. And magnify God. Then answered Peter, can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? And he commanded them to be baptized, them, not only Cornelius. The other people did not see any angel. The other people were not visited by angels. It was only Cornelius that saw the angel, heard the angel, but he brought other people in. But he brought his friends in. And then those friends were baptized in the Holy Ghost and were baptized in water in the name of the Lord. Then preached they were now the people saying, this is so good, it must not stop. And all your friends who are bringing on Sunday, on Thursday, they will say, this is so good, it must not stop. Amen. Then prayed they him to tarry certain days. As I said, tonight we're looking at the message, cultivating true friendship and reaping its benefits. There are three things we're looking at. Number one, the corruption and contamination by ungodly friends. We need to understand that. We need to know the warnings of the scriptures that there is corruption, there's contamination by ungodly friends. The corruption and the contamination by ungodly friends. Number two, our commission and cultivation of uplifting friendliness. Our commission and cultivation of uplifting friendliness. We have a commission, and the commission is concerning the friendliness we have or demonstrate in a community to be uplifting, and we cultivate that. And it's like a commission, a command that must be done. We're not saying, okay, let it happen by itself. I'm not going to take the initiative. I'm not going to make the move. If anything is going to happen, let it happen by itself. No, you have a commission and you must cultivate this, the commission and the cultivation of uplifting friendliness. Number three, the comprehension and consecration to the ultimate friend. The comprehension and consecration to the ultimate friend. We're coming back to number one. In number one, we're looking at the corruption and contamination by ungodly friends. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, reading from verse 33. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 33, it says, be not deceived. Evil communications corrupt good manners. Evil communications corrupt good manners. Actually, saints and sinners cannot be intimate friends. A saint, positive. A sinner, negative. To be so closely associated and intimate that they're walking together, talking together, thinking together, eating together, going places together, doing all things together. No, that cannot happen, really. Because saints and sinners do not match. Sinners are our neighbors. They are not our bosom friends, trusted friends. We love them as neighbors, just like Jesus loved publicans and sinners, not as partners and saints. You see, Jesus Christ loved Peter in a way he was not loving the Pharisees. That is, the love of Jesus for Peter, for John, and for James, and for those disciples is higher, is greater, is broader, is deeper than his love for the publicans. He loved the publicans to save them. He loved the publicans. You know, if a publican invited him to come and eat in the house, he'll go there. And you eat there so as to make use of that opportunity to preach the gospel and save the soul. But he wasn't partners with them. Believers cannot be unequally yoked together with unbelievers in association, in business, in a covenant relationship, in intimate fellowship or intimate friendship. Ungodly friends deceive. You're going to find that all over the scriptures. Ungodly friends disguise. Do you remember Ahab and Jehoshaphat? And Ahab said, Jehoshaphat, I'm going to war. And these Ramoth Gilead people, they've been away from us, and I'm going to them, I'm going to seize them. And Jehoshaphat said, is there any prophet here that can give us a word? And then they collected false prophets together, and they prophesied, go and you are going to win the battle. And Jehoshaphat, a good king, he knew that this one is fake, this one is phony. He said, is there any other prophet we can call that can tell us something more than what these 400 people, a crowd of false witnesses, false prophets are saying? He said, yes, there is one, but I hate him. You can tell. That's a sinner. I hate him. You can tell it's not a good friend. Or Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat did not get the information very well. And so he said, don't say like that. Call him. And then Micaiah came. And then he prophesied. Eventually he said, tell me the truth now. Why are you hiding the truth from me? Okay. You want the truth? This is what is going to happen. Did you hear everybody? Jehoshaphat, I told you, I hate this man. I hate this man. And then they went to the battle. But Ahab told Jehoshaphat, disguise yourself. Do you remember the story? And I will disguise myself and be like an ordinary person. You will go in like a king. Those are ungodly friends. And when the enemy camped, when they saw him, they said, that's the king, get rid of him. And then Jehoshaphat called on the Lord. And that's how eventually his life was saved. And Ahab still died his death. You will not die another person's death. Ungodly friends deceive. Ungodly friends disguise. Ungodly friends defraud. You know, they say they are friends and bring them home. That's where my something is. That's where that one is. And they defraud. Ungodly friends defile. That's what they do. Because they're not saved. They're ungodly. They're unrighteous. And they do not know the way of the Lord. They defile. Ungodly friends dominate. That's, you know, they say, you know, they are your friend, but they always want to take the final decision. They want to run your life, and they want to ruin your life because they're ungodly. Ungodly friends destroy, and eventually, ungodly friends will damn the soul eternally in hellfire. You are not going to be friends with, I mean, intimate friend. Yes, we're witness to them, their neighbors. We're witness to them, we talk to them. They need the word we have. But when it comes to real intimacy, we cannot be intimate with them. Look at Proverbs chapter 22. Proverbs chapter 22, And I'm reading from verse 24, Proverbs chapter 22, verse 24. Make no friends with an angry man, and with a furious man thou shalt not go. You can read it this way too. Make no friends with a sinful man, for and with a furious man thou shalt not go. Make no friends, no friendship with a defiled man, a defiling man, a fraudulent man, a wicked man, a hellish man, and with a furious man, thou shalt not go. Why? Look at verse 25. Lest thou learn his ways and get a snare to thy soul. Be very watchful. Be very careful. Let me show you an illustration. In 2 Samuel chapter 13. 2 Samuel chapter 13. Here we're looking at a so-called friend. 2 Samuel chapter 13. And I'm reading from verse 3. But Amnon had a friend, whose name was Jonadab, the son of Shimeah, David's brother. And Jonadab was a very subtle man, crafty man. And it says, and he said unto him, why art thou been the king's son, lean from day to day? Wilt thou not tell me, am I not your friend? Tell me, what's your problem? And Amnon said unto him, I love Tamar, my brother Absalom's sister. And Jonadab said unto him, you don't know what to do. Okay, I'll tell you what to do. The counseling of an ungodly friend, the advice of a sinful friend, make no friendship with an angry man or a defiled man or a terribly wicked man. It says, lay thee down on thy bed and make thyself sick. And when thy father cometh to see thee, say unto him, I pray thee, let my sister Tamar come and give me meat and dress the meat in my sight, that I may eat, that I may see it and eat it of her at her hand. Well, that was the plot. That was the thing he was to do, and he did that, and eventually he forced Tamar. But you know, Absalom told Tamar, as your brother defiled you, don't worry about that. Absalom too, a cunning person, a crafty person, he said nothing. Look at verse 20. In verse 20, and Absalom, her brother, said unto her, as Amnon thy brother been with thee, but behold now, hold thy peace, my sister. He is thy brother. Regard not this thing. So Tamar remained desolate in her brother Absalom's house. You see that? It's like, Absalom did not show any emotion, did not show that he was going to do any evil thing. Verse 29. And the servants of Absalom did unto Amnon as Absalom had commanded. What did they do? Is the church there? I said, what did they do? They killed him. And all the king's sons arose. Every man got him up upon his mule and fled. Look at verse 30. And it came to pass, while they were in the way, that tidings came to David, saying, Absalom has slain all the king's sons, and there is not one of them left. That's exaggeration. Then the king arose and tear his garments and lay on the earth. And then he goes on, and all the servants stood by with their clothes rent. And Jonadab, who is Jonadab? The friend of Amnon. Amnon has taken to his advice Amnon is killed. Amnon is now dead. And Jonadab, the son of Shemaiah, so David's brother, answered and said, "Let not my lord suppose that they have slain all the young men, the king's son, for Amnon only is dead." Look at a so-called friend. Only Amnon is dead. He was not even mourning. He was not sorrowful. And he was not shedding any tears, that it was because of my advice, my counseling to Amnon that got him into this. Now he's dead. Now he's gone to hell. And he said, only Amnon is dead. Look at this. "For by the appointment of Absalom, this had been determined from the day that he forced his sister Tamar." And this Jonadab knew, so-called friend, he knew that evil was coming on Absalom because of his advice and because of what he had done. And Absalom, Jonadab did nothing. He didn't want Jonadab, when Absalom said, "I'm, you know, sharing my sheep," and then let all the people come and let Amnon come. He didn't go behind secretly to tell him, "If you go there, there is trouble." No, because he wasn't a real friend, a good friend. I pray I will not have such friends in Jesus' name. Amen. Esther chapter 5. Esther chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 10. In Esther chapter 5, verse 10, here is the story of Haman. And this Haman, he hated Mordecai. And so, you know the story. Let me just read this part to you. Reading from verse 10, it says in Esther chapter 5, verse 10, "Nevertheless, Haman refrained himself. And when he came home, he sent and called for" who? "His friends and Zeresh, his wife. And Haman told them of the glory of his riches and the multitude of his children and all the things wherein the king had promised him, and how he had advanced him above the princes, advanced him above the princes and servants of the king." Look at this. "And Haman said, moreover, yea, Esther the queen did let no man come in with the king unto the banquet that she had prepared, but" who? "Myself, and tomorrow I am invited unto her also with the king. Yet all this availeth me nothing, so long as I see Mordecai the Jew sitting at the king's gate." Look at this now. "Then said Zeresh, his wife, and all his friends unto him, let a gallows be made of 50 cubits high, and tomorrow speak thou unto the king that Mordecai may be hanged thereon. Then go thou in merrily, happily, joyfully, cheerfully with the king unto the banquet." And the scene pleased Haman, and he caused the gallows to be made. Advice from friends, corrupt friends, wicked friends. Look at chapter 7. Chapter 7, verse 9. Chapter 7, verse 9. "And Habona, one of the chamberlains, said before the king, behold also the gallows 50 cubits high, which Haman had made for Mordecai, who had spoken good for the king, standeth in the house of Haman." Then the king said, "Hang him thereon." You see, bad friends and terrible friends, wicked friends, they will counsel a person in a way that eventually will bring doom, damnation to such a person. We're looking at Job chapter 19. Job chapter 19. I'm reading here from verse 14, Job chapter 19, verse 14. You remember the case of Job? You remember the sickness that came upon him? You remember the calamity that came upon him? But look at his friends. It says in chapter 19, verse 14, my kinsfolk have failed. My familiar friends have forgotten me. They have forgotten my righteousness. They have forgotten the quality of my character. Look at what they are saying against me. And then come to verse 19. Verse 19 says, all my inward friends abhorred me, and they whom I loved are turned against me. Lamentation chapter 1. In Lamentation chapter 1, these are bad friends. These are wicked friends. These are ungodly friends. These are righteous, unsaved friends. Lamentation chapter 1, verse 2. She weepeth sore in the night, and her tears are on her cheeks. Among all her lovers, she has none to comfort her. All her friends have dealt treacherously with her. They have become her enemies. At the time when she needed them most, at the time when she wanted love most, that's the time they disappointed. I pray you'll not have friends like that in Jesus' name. We're coming back to Proverbs. Proverbs. And we're reading here from verse, from chapter 18, verse 24. Proverbs, chapter 18. We're reading from verse 24. A man that has friends must show himself friendly. And there is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. We're now coming to the area of good friendship, the area of profitable, practical friendship. The friendship we're talking about here now goes both ways. You're a believer, you cannot live in isolation. You're a child of God, you cannot be in isolation. You must have friends, the friends that stick closer than the brother. There are times of temptation, times of trial, times of difficulty, and it's those friends, brothers, children of God, sisters, children of God, that will lift you up, that will succor you, that will help you, and that will move you forward. When you are discouraged, you need somebody to come alongside, and courage, encouragement will come in Jesus' name. Look at that again. A man that has friends must show himself friendly. As a child of God, you have friends, you have children of God. Yes, we're all brothers and sisters. We all love everyone. But you know, you cannot be intimate with everyone. There are some individual brothers, individual sisters you are close to, and they're close to you. And you must make sure you cultivate that friendship, you nurture that friendship, you build that friendship, and you make sure that that friendship is actually what it ought to be. We're looking at Psalm 55. Psalm 55, I'm reading from verse 14. Psalm 55, reading from verse 14. We took sweet counsel together. Those are friends. And walked into the house, unto the house of God in company. You see, there are times you might be discouraged. I don't think I want to go to. And then your friend comes by and he says, you're not dressed up yet, let's go. And it, you don't understand that it is at that time you really need a good friend, that you know, you come and something good will happen to you in Jesus' name. You know, let me give you this testimony of, you know, a sister here in Lagos. She had a child that was sick, and in fact she was afraid the child might even die. And eventually, they went to the church, and in the church there, at the local church, it's like, you know, the child was feeling so tired and so weak, and the pain was too much. It was like, why did they even come? And so during the service, I think they had done, said the scripture, they then went back home, because they felt that, you know, it was terrible for her, for that child to be in church. And the husband just came, maybe, I don't know whether the husband went to night duty or whatever, and then came to the house and saw the wife, and saw the child, and said, ah, today is Sunday, why are you not in church? And they said, well, we went to church actually, but see the condition of this child, and I'm even afraid what's going to happen to your child. And the husband said, please, let's go back to the church. And the wife did not argue, and they went back to the church, and we were having transmission of a good transmission is always good. I said transmission always good. Then the transmission came, and while the message was still going on, healing came from heaven, and that child was healed. And then at the end, you know, the child was okay, and it was like nothing happened before. But for the husband that came and said, please go back to the church, that's what a friend will do. That's what a companion will do. That's what somebody who is near will do. When you think, I don't think I can go to church, I don't think I can be there, look at that verse 14. We took sweet counsel together and walked unto the house of God in a company. We're looking at Psalm 119. I'm reading from verse 63. Psalm 119 verse 63. I am a companion of all them that fear thee, of them that keep thy precepts. A companion of them that love you, of them that fear you. Look at chapter 122. Psalm 122, we're reading from verse 1. It says, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I was glad. A friend came near, a friend came by and said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Proverbs chapter 17, verse 17. Proverbs chapter 17, verse 17. A friend loveth when? At all times. A friend loveth at all times. You know, sometimes you mistakenly did something, you know, and your conscience being very sensitive, you felt bad. I made a fool of myself. I shouldn't have done that. I shouldn't have said that. I shouldn't have gotten involved with that. And you find it difficult to forgive yourself. And then a friend comes by, and he can tell, because you are friends, he knows by your look, he knows by, you know, the way you position yourself, your countenance, something is wrong. And then he says, something is wrong. You say, yes, something more than something. Because, you know, look at what I did, look at what I said, look at what where I went. And I was surprised. I could find myself in such a situation. You know, if you are telling somebody who is false, not a real friend, you say, that's what you did. Okay, have you reported yourself? What they are concerned about is report. They are not concerned about forgiveness. They are not concerned about how you can come out of it. But a friend loveth at all times. A friend at such a time will show love to you. I thought you were going to say amen. Yeah. And a brother is born for adversity. That is, when you are going through times of sickness and times of challenge, a brother is born for adversity. Chapter 22, verse 11. Chapter 22, I'm reading from verse 11. He that loveth pureness of heart, for the grace of his lips, the king shall be his friend. He that loveth pureness of a heart, for the grace, for the love, for the good things he says, even the king shall be his friend. What we're talking about is a king very high, and you a common person, yet you can be friends together. There are people who are up there, and there are people who are maybe prosperous and whatever, and yet because of your lifestyle, they just take to you and they love you, and you are friends. But remember, you must maintain that friendship. Remember, you must cultivate that friendship. Remember, you must make sure you nurture that friendship. And I pray that our friendship will be beneficial in Jesus' name. Chapter 27 of Proverbs. Proverbs chapter 27, I'm reading from verse 9. Proverbs 27, reading from verse 9. It says, ointment and perfume rejoice the heart. So does the sweetness of a man's friend by hearty counsel. That is, your mind, your language, your mind, your action. You are not say, going to say, it's my friend, I can say anything. It's my friend, I can rub him the negative way. No, you will mind your language. He loves you, love him. He expects you to be like an ointment, like comfort unto him. That's why it says, so does the sweetness of a man's friend. Sweet language, good language, profitable language, practical language by hearty counsel. Look at verse 17 there. Verse 17 there, it says, iron sharpness iron. What that means is, you have a knife, you have a cutlass, and it's blunt. And it cannot, cut anything. It cannot do the work it ought to do. It's made of iron. And then there's file. The file is also made of iron. And then the file, which is iron, sharpness the cutlass, or sharpness the other thing, which is also iron. Iron sharpness iron. So a man sharpness the countenance of his friend. That means you're built for encouragement, and you nurture that encouragement. We're coming to Luke chapter 5. We're reading here from verse 27. Luke chapter 5, we're reading from verse 27. It says, after these things, he went forth and saw a publican named Levi sitting at the receipt of custom. And he said unto him, follow me. And he left all, rose up, and he followed him. And Levi, a new convert, and Levi, the publican who was converted, who was now following Jesus Christ, and Levi, this person that came newly into the kingdom of God, he thought about his companions. He thought about publicans like himself. He thought about, I have peace, let them have peace. I have joy, they must have joy. I have salvation with assurance, they must have this same assurance of salvation. And it says, Levi made a great feast in his own house, and there was a great company of which kind of people? Publicans like himself. They have been friends, they have been acquaintances, they have been on the same profession, and of others that sat down with them, and their scribes and Pharisees murmured against his disciples, saying, why do ye eat and drink with publicans and sinners? Is this those sad people, Sadducees? They were sad, they were unhappy people. And when anything good is going on, they carry their sadness even to that good thing. Why? They're always asking why. They're not thinking about the good attitude of Matthew. Lord, that's Levi. His name is also Matthew. And they were not thinking of what he did. And he showed friendliness. A man that has friends must show himself friendly. And when he has seen something good and something beautiful, he'll show it to his friends. And Jesus answering said unto them, them. They that are whole need not a physician, but they that are sick. I came not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Come to Luke chapter 16. Luke chapter 16, I'm reading from verse 9. Luke chapter 16, we're reading from verse 9. In verse 9, Luke chapter 16, verse 9. And I say unto you, here is Christ talking now. Make yourselves, tell me, friends of the mammon of righteousness, that when ye fail, they may receive you into everlasting habitations. Ah, look at that verse. That verse is difficult for some people. Let me explain to you. Jesus said, make yourselves friends. Go out, get friends, reach out, make them your friends. How do you do that? Well, the mammon of unrighteousness is referring to money there. It's saying, because money generally, people get money through unrighteousness, unrighteous ways, unrighteous policies, unrighteous trade. But you have got your own in a nice way, in a normal way. But that money is still referred to as mammon of unrighteousness. Look at this. Let me read it. Let me substitute the word money for you to understand. And I say unto you, make yourselves friends with money. That is the money you have, you spend on people. The money you have, when they're sick, you spend on them. Like that man, the Samaritan, that saw the one that was left half dead and then took him to the inn and he spent his money with mammon of unrighteousness. Or it is that somebody is sick, somebody has just delivered a child, or somebody has a need, somebody has lost the job, he cannot pay out rent. Make yourself friends with the money you have. Then it says that when ye fail, that is eventually when you die, eventually when money fails and nothing will buy a place in heaven, when ye fail, when you die, they would have gone to heaven before you, and they will receive you into everlasting habitations. They'll be waiting for you already. Some of them are older than you are, and some of them die before you die, and you have made friends with them. You brought them into the gospel, you brought them into salvation. You spent your money, you gave your house, you gave your vehicle, you did a lot of things for them that eventually got them saved, and then they have gone to the great beyond before you. And then when eventually you die, there will be hundreds and thousands and millions of people waiting for you, and when you come in to through those party gates to heaven, they say, here he is, the one God used to bring me to salvation. Why, if not for him, I would not be in heaven today. And they receive you into the everlasting habitation. I thought there would be a good amen there. And so that's what we learn. We're looking at John chapter 1. John chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 40. John chapter 1, and I'm reading here from verse 40. It says in verse 41, of the two which heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. And it says, and he first findeth his own brother, Simon, and says unto him, we have found the Messiah. Have you found the Messiah? Yeah. Then you'll tell somebody, you'll tell a brother, you'll tell a relative, or you will tell a friend, which is being interpreted the Christ. And he brought him to Jesus. He brought him to Jesus. That's a real friend. That's a good friend. That's a real friend. And it says, and when Jesus beheld him, he said, thou art Simon, the son of Jonah. Thou shalt be called Cephas, which is being interpreted, a stone. And so you see that Peter became such an important person in the kingdom of God. I pray that your converts will become important personalities in the kingdom of God in Jesus' name. Let me summarize this second point. How do we recognize a true friend? If you say, I have a friend, and if I say, I have a friend, How do we recognize that this is a friend indeed? What do you do? What do I do? So that I can manifest myself and show myself, and you can show yourself as a true friend, as a godly friend, as a helpful friend, as a profitable friend. A true friend associates and assists as a companion. A true friend comes alongside you, he associates with you, he assists you as a companion. A true friend bears burdens in crisis. You go through a crisis, you find yourself in crisis, a real friend, a true friend will come alongside and bear burdens with you in that crisis. You know, but sometimes if you have crisis, if you have a problem, and then maybe financial crisis, maybe family crisis, maybe professional crisis, maybe your place of work, and then all the friends, we can't find them. I mean, brother, and I can't find anybody. I mean, sister, I can't find anybody. The true friends will come to bear burdens in crisis. A true friend cares and counsels with confidence. A true friend will come to you and he cares for you and he says, I know you will come out of this. I know that this sin is not going to be forever. And he counsels you with the confidence that you will overcome. And true, true, you will overcome. Yeah. I say you will overcome. Yeah. A true friend delivers from danger at any cost. A true friend sees you in danger and he says, whatever the cost, whatever the price, my friend must come out of this. A true friend sees you and he says, this sin you are going through, you must overcome. And thank God you will overcome. When you cannot pray, they will pray with you. When you are discouraged, they will lift you up. When it appears you are giving up on your sin, well, this danger, it has come, what can I do? When you can do nothing, these true friends will come around you and they deliver you from danger at any cost. A true friend evangelizes. A true friend elevates. A true friend edifies. Is a true friend, and then he sees that you are not in the Lord, you are not in the gospel, you are not born again. If it's a true friend, he will evangelize. And then if it's a true friend, you are down, he will lift you up, he will elevate you. A true friend will edify with conviction. With conviction, he has conviction in the word of God, he has conviction that God loves you. And if nobody is demonstrating that love to you, he demonstrates the love to you. A true friend feeds and fortifies to be new creatures in Christ. It says, old things must pass away in my friend's life. It's not the one going about and say, it says he's born again, but you know, it's still like his old self. It's still doing the same old thing. And when you mistakenly go back to those old days, you say, didn't I say so? Didn't I say so? It's not born again. It's not a child of God. But a real friend, he'll come alongside. He'll feed you and he'll fortify you, strengthen you to be a real new creature. A true friend grows in giving without complaining. A true friend is giving and giving and giving. He never complains. I'm only the one always giving to him. He never gives anything back. He's a true friend and he's giving and he's growing in giving without complaining. A true friend helps without counting the cost. A true friend helps without counting the cost. Do you have a true friend, by the way? And do you have people like this? They just help you. They're not counting the cost. And they're not saying, I spent up to this amount. That's not important to them. Until you come out of that predicament, a true friend is always there. A true friend is always lifting you up. Until you totally come out clean and clear, and you are the person you ought to be, a true friend keeps on helping without counting the cost. A true friend intercedes with concern. It's a true friend. And this is a problem. And it's like, you see this mountain, how will this mountain move? If you have a true friend, he'll agree with you in prayer. I said he will agree with you in prayer. I know you are writing, so, but it's not your mouth writing, it's the hand that is writing. You can say amen with your mouth while your hand is writing. I'm a true friend. No, what I mean myself, I'm a true friend. I am your friend. And you are going to succeed in Jesus' name. I will pray for you. I will intercede for you. And that thing that is bringing tears to your eyes will dry up in Jesus' name. Until you overcome, I will not stop praying for you. Until you see the back of the devil and it's running away from you, my intercession for you will continue in Jesus' name. Remember, when you get into a problem and you say you cannot overcome, Jesus is praying for you. I am praying for you too. A true friend joins the joyful without compromise. You are happy about something, a true friend is happy, and a true friend joins you in that joy of the Lord. It's not going to compromise with you. If there's anything to compromise, he says, no, I will not compromise. But when you are happy, I'm happy with you. He joins the joyful without compromise. A true friend keeps away from corruption and condemnation. A true friend will keep you away from anything he knows. He knows, my friend, he's ignorant. He doesn't understand. He thinks that this is a good business. He thinks that this is a good deal. But I know it's going to be dangerous for him. It will corrupt him. It will condemn him. It will destroy him. A good friend will keep you away from corruption and condemnation. A true friend liberates and loves. He loves you and liberates you from the curse. From the curse. Every curse in your life, you have a true friend, all the curses are taken away. Amen. The curses are broken in Jesus' name. Amen. It's not somebody you come to and you say, you know, I've been looking at this in my life. And I remember now that, you know, when we were young, we did something to an old man. And we made fun of him, and the old man, he knew about that. And that man, I remember now what he said. He said, when you become old, all the children, little children, will do this to you. And he cursed us. It's not if somebody that will say, so that's what you did. And that you see now, that you are learning a lesson. You are learning a lesson. That's a lesson for you that, you know, you should not do something like that. If he's a real friend, he will love you. And he will say, don't worry about that. We'll take it to the Lord in prayer. And I'm looking at you there. Every curse is broken in Jesus' name. He liberates you from the curse of the enemy. A true friend motivates and moves you up for courage. He says, don't look down, don't go back, don't draw back. He'll pump courage into you. He will inject courage into you. A true friend will motivate you. A true friend will mobilize all forces that are available and move you on and move you up with courage. A true friend neutralizes all contentions. It's a real friend, and you know something is happening and it's going to bring contention. A real friend knows how to remove that friction, how to remove that contention. A true friend knows how to soften everything, you know, so that all the conflicts and the contentions, everything will vanish away. A true friend outgrows old carnalities. A true friend outgrows old carnalities. What that means is, when you first became friends, when you first became companions, there were some carnal traits that you knew in him, and the thing always annoys you. The thing always gets on your nerves. But, you know, you say, I love him. I don't want you. I know he has some peculiarities, some idiosyncrasies, and, you know, some things he always says, he jabs you, that, you know, you will feel the pain. If you're a true friend, you will outgrow those old carnalities. And then your friend will say, remember, it's nicer now, it's better now. I know this used to happen, that used to happen, but he's a true friend. He has outgrown old carnalities. A true friend persuades you to continue with Christ. Persuasion all the time. And anytime you are dragging back, you are dressing back, a true friend persuades you to continue with Christ. A true friend quits whatever is contemptible. A true friend quits Whatever is contemptible. You know, something happens, you're moving together, and then, you know, he does something, he says something, you know, and you can see from the look of your friend, that thing is contemptible. That thing is a no-go area. How could I say that? And a true friend, once he knows and once he can tell that that thing offends him, that thing offends her, a true friend quits whatever is contemptible. A true friend reflects the character of Christ. The character of Christ, the sympathy of Christ, the goodness of Christ, the mercy of Christ, the gentleness of Christ, the meekness of Christ. A true friend reflects the character of Christ. A true friend serves without covetousness. He's serving you. He's not asking for anything back. He's serving because he just loves to serve. He said, "It's my friend," and then you said, "You've done that for me again. It's my joy. It's my pleasure. And I'll do more if I have the chance." A true friend serves without demanding anything back, without covetousness. A true friend takes converts to the central congregation. A true friend takes converts to the central congregation. A true friend is in the service, in the worship service, and he hears beautiful music. And so he's thinking about his friend. I wish my friend were here to hear this. A true friend is in the service and he's hearing the question and the answer, and then the answer so interested him. He said, "I wish my friend were here to hear the answer to this question." A true friend hears the message, and it's a simple message, but you know, it's so enlightening. And he's saying, "I wish my friend were here to hear such a message like this." A true friend takes the converts to the central congregation. A true friend upholds clear conscience in companionship. We're companions together, and yet a true friend will not do anything that will condemn his conscience, that will soil his conscience, that will soil and make dirty his pure garment. A true friend upholds clear conscience in companionship. A true friend values the holy calling and the heavenly crown. A true friend says, "I have a holy calling. I still value that. A friendship will not make me to forget my calling. A friendship will not make me to forget the heavenly crown." And a true friend will recommend that same holy calling and that same heavenly crown to his friend. A true friend values the holy calling and the heavenly crown. A true friend wins with convincing communication. A true friend is winsome with convincing communication. You know, he always learns, since this person became his friend, he's learned a new language that is winsome, a new language that is, you know, interesting to the person. And in fact, the person wants to come back to you, wants to come back because I want to hear him talk. I want to hear him say something to me because his communication is always convincing. A true friend exemplifies Christ-like companionship. It's like Christ has sent me another comforter. He sent me the Holy Ghost, but he has sent me a spirit-filled person that is just having Christ-like sympathy and Christ-like empathy and Christ-like communication, compassion, and togetherness. A true friend yields to correction without contradiction. You know, you are walking together, you are moving together, and you know, it's your friend and your friends together, and you say something, "You didn't see anything wrong in that. That's just me, that's just you, that's just the way you felt it should be done." And a friend corrects you gently and he says, "My friend, you know, there's a passage of scripture. Let me open it to you." And he opens the passage of scripture and he says, "Because of this, that is wrong." If a true friend, yields to correction without contradiction, without saying, "That verse, let me show you another verse to prove that what I did, it may be wrong, it's not too bad after all." A true friend yields to correction without contradiction. A true friend zeroes in on conquering with the Lord. Conquering with the Lord. That's a true friend. That's a true friend. He zeroes in. Zeroes in. He concentrates. He focuses on winning the race and conquering with the Lord. Let me come to point number three now. The comprehension and consecration to the ultimate friend. The comprehension and the consecration to the ultimate friend. The ultimate friend is Christ. We're coming to John chapter 15. John chapter 15. I'm reading from verse 13. John chapter 15. What verse are we looking for here? Verse 13. Look at this. Greater love has no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. That's Christ. That's Christ. That's the ultimate friend. That's the uppermost friend. And that is the one that loves us, and he loves us to the uttermost. He says in verse 14, ye are my friends, ye are my friends, if ye do whatsoever I command you. He says, I'm your friend. I lay down my life. I take the initiative. I make the first move. I lay down my life for you. Now you must respond. You must reciprocate. And if I lay down my life for you, all I'm asking for you to keep this friendship is that you keep my commandments and you do whatsoever I command you. Look at verse 15. Henceforth, I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth. But I have called you. What's he calling you? I said, what's he calling you? But I've called you friends, for all things that I've heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. That's our friend. Jesus is our friend. Jesus is your friend. And you are friends with Jesus. Look at Luke chapter 12. Luke chapter 12. I'm reading from verse 4. Luke chapter 12. I'm reading from verse 4. And I say unto you, my friends. What a wonderful thing that Jesus Christ, he didn't, you know, say this in the private. He said it in the public. He said, I say unto you, my friends, be not afraid of them that kill the body, and after that they have no more than they can do. But I will forewarn you whom ye shall fear. You see, if you're a friend, you'll tell your friends the truth, and you'll tell them what will make them escape hellfire. And I'm telling you all that I'm telling you, so that in the, by the grace of the Lord, you will escape hellfire. It says, fear him which after he has killed has power to cast into hell. Yea, I say unto you, fear him. But now he continues to talk to his friends. Thank God, I'm a friend of Jesus. I said, thank God, I'm a friend of Jesus. That's how much a friend you are. You're a friend of Jesus, and this friendship with Jesus will be profitable in your life in Jesus' name. Look at verse 6. Look at verse 6. And not five sparrows sold for two farthings, and not one of them is forgotten before God. You will not be forgotten. And but even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Fear not, therefore, ye of more value than many sparrows. It's telling you that you have much value than many sparrows, because he's your friend, and he is friend, and he has provided everything for you. Look at verse 32. He's talking to his friends, and thank God I'm one of them. Look at verse 32. Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. You'll have the kingdom in Jesus' name. Now, when it says we are his friends, can we look at an example in the scriptures that shows us that if we are his friends, this is the relationship, friendship relationship that takes place between us and him. Look at James chapter 2. James chapter 2, reading from verse 23. James chapter 2, verse 23. And the scripture was fulfilled, which says, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. That's all it takes. That's all it takes. Christ has given his life for you. He died for you on the cross of Calvary. And it is written for us in the scriptures. The moment you believe that, Abraham believed God, it was counted to him for righteousness, and then he became the friend of God. The moment you believe the gospel, the word of the Lord, you become a friend of Christ. I said you become a friend of Christ. Are you a friend of Christ? Have you believed the Lord Jesus Christ? He will take care of you. Look at Isaiah chapter 41. Isaiah chapter 41. I'm reading from verse 8. Isaiah chapter 41. Reading from verse 8. It says in verse 8, "But thou, Israel, art my servant, Jacob, whom I have chosen, the seed of Abraham." Tell me. My friend, the seed of Abraham, my friend. How did he say my friend here now? You see, this is the second time we're reading that Abraham was a friend of God. The first time, it was because he believed the Lord, and the Lord counted it for righteousness. This time now, it's because he obeyed the Lord. Look at Genesis chapter 22. Genesis chapter 22. I'm reading from verse 1. A friend of God because he believed. Number 2, a friend of God because he obeyed. Look at chapter 22 of Genesis, verse 1. "And it came to pass after these things that God did test, tried Abraham, and said unto him," Abraham, "and he said, Behold, here I am." When God called him, he didn't act as if he didn't hear, to turn a deaf ear. When your friend calls you, you'll not be saying, "He's asking for something again. He's going to demand something again." No, you don't have that attitude. "Behold, here I am." And he said, "Take now thy son, thy only son Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I will tell thee of." And Abraham, tell me. And Abraham, say it aloud, rose up early in the morning, because God is friend, has asked him, "Give me your son, give me your son." And there was nothing too high, nothing too great, and nothing too precious, nothing too priceless that he couldn't give to his friend. He said, "I'm a friend of God. My friend is asking for my son." Look at this. "And he saddled his ass, and he took two of his young men with him, and I seek his son, and clave the wood for the burnt offering, and rose up and went unto the place which God I told him. Then on the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes, and he saw the place afar off. And Abraham said unto the young men, Abide here, abide ye here with the ass, and I and the lad will go yonder and worship. And what will happen? And come again to you." I'm going to give something to my friend, and I know that my friend is going to, you know, polish that thing, beautify that thing, and give new life to that thing, and then we'll give it back to, we'll give that thing back to me, and then we will come back. That's a friend. That's a friend. Joyfully, happily, he was going to give this to his friend. And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it upon Isaac his son, and he took the fire in his hand and a knife, and they went both of them together. And Isaac spake unto Abraham his father and said, "My father." And he said, "Here I am, my son. Here am I, my son." And he said, "Behold the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering?" And Abraham said, "My son, my son, my son, God," tell me, "will provide
Oh, he's a friend. He's a friend. He knows what to do. He knows all things. He has all things. I'm just his friend. And he is richer than I am. I have only one son. He has 1,000 rams on the hill. He says God will provide himself a lamb for the burnt offering. And it says they went together. And then it says, and they came to the place which God had told him up, and Abraham built an altar there and laid the wood in order, and bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar upon the wood. And Abraham stretched forth his hand and took the knife to slay his son. He was going to actually give the son to God. He was actually going to offer the son as a burnt offering to his friend. And the angel of the Lord called unto him out of heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, here am I. Here am I. I'm always here. And when my friend, when God calls me, he will hear. Here I am. You will be there in Jesus' name. And he said, lay not thy hand upon the lad, neither do thou anything unto him. For now I know that thou fearest God, seeing that thou hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, from me. And Abraham lifted up his eyes, and he looked, and behold, behind him a ram caught in a thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered him up for a burnt offering in the stead of his son. And Abraham called the name of the place Jehovah Jireh. God will provide for you. As it is said to this day, in the mouth of the Lord it shall be seen. And the angel of the Lord called unto Abraham out of heaven the second time and said, by myself have I sworn, says the Lord, for because thou hast done this sin and hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, that in blessing I will bless thee, and in multiplying I will multiply thy seed as the stars of the heaven and as the sand which is upon the seashore, and thy seed shall possess the gate of his enemies. And in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed because thou hast obeyed my voice. That's why I was a friend of God. A friend of God that offered greatly unto the Lord. When you're a friend of Christ, you'll offer. You offer yourself, you offer your life, you offer your money, you offer your resources, you offer everything to build up the kingdom of Christ. And look at 2 Chronicles chapter 20. 2 Chronicles chapter 20. I'm reading from verse 7. Here is the third time that Abraham is called a friend of God. Look at 2 Chronicles chapter 20. And we're reading from verse 7. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 7. Art not thou our God, who didst drive out the inhabitants of this land before thy people Israel, and gavest it to the seed of Abraham thy friend for how long? Forever. Thy friend for how long? Forever. Look up here. Did Abraham go to heaven? Yes. Remember that Lazarus was in Abraham's bosom, because Abraham was a friend of God here. And a friend, now after he died, he now went to live with his friend, with God, forever and ever. But the point is this: you gave this to your friend Abraham. The question is, when was that land given to Abraham, his friend? Genesis chapter 13. In Genesis chapter 13, here I'm reading from verse 5. Genesis chapter 13, verse 5. This one, he gave this to his friend. Look at this. And Lot also, which went with Abraham, had flocks and herds and tents. And the land was not able to bear them that they might dwell together, for their substance was great, so that they could not dwell together. And there was a strife between the herdsmen of Abram's cattle and the herdmen of Lot's cattle. And the Canaanites and the Perizzites dwelt then in the land. And Abram said unto Lot, let there be no strife, I pray thee, between me and thee. That's a friend. Let there be no quarrel. Let there be no disagreement. Let there be no conflict. Let there be no strife between me and thee, between my herdmen and thy herdmen, for we are brethren. And it says, is not the whole land before thee? But separate thyself, I pray thee, from me. If thou wilt take to the left hand, then I will go to the right. And if thou wilt depart to the right hand, then I will go to the left. And Lot lifted up his eyes and beheld all the plain of Jordan, that it was well watered everywhere before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, even as the garden of the Lord, like the garden of like the land of Egypt, as thou comest unto Zoar. Then Lot chose him all the plain of Jordan, and Lot journeyed east, and they separated themselves one from the other. And Abram dwelt in the land of Canaan, and Lot dwelt in the cities of the plain, and pitched his tent towards Sodom. But the men of Sodom were wicked and sinners before the Lord exceedingly. And the Lord said unto Abram his friend, after that Lot separated from him, lift up now thine eyes, look from the place where thou art northward, they are yours. Southward, it's yours. Eastward, it's yours. Westward, it's yours. For all the land which thou seest to thee will I give it unto thy seed. For how long? Forever. And that's his friend. That's his friend. You gave the land to Abraham, your friend. And you see the times was called the friend of God. The same thing with us. Now we are friends with Jesus Christ. Friendship with Jesus will separate us from sin and darkness. Friendship with Jesus will separate us from all the works of Satan. Friendship with Jesus will make us love souls whom Jesus died for and reach out in love to save them. While we seek to rescue the perishing, we'll watch and pray so that we ourselves will not perish. And thank God you will not perish. And because Jesus Christ is our friend, because Abraham was a friend of God, God gave him everything, gave him the whole land. And because we are friends of Christ, I am a friend of Christ. Where's the friend of Christ there? All things are yours in Jesus' name. God gave it to Abraham because he was his friend. He said, look northward, southward, eastward, westward, everything have I given unto you. Look at Romans chapter 8 verse 32. Romans chapter 8 verse 32. He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give you all things? You have them in Jesus' name. All those things are yours. All the blessings of God are yours. And you are going to possess them in Jesus' name. 1 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 21. 1 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 21. Therefore, let no man glory in men, for all things are yours. Do you have anything today? I said, do you have anything today? All things are yours because we're his friends. We're looking at 2 Peter chapter 2. 2 Peter chapter 1 rather. 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 3. According as his divine power has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that has called us to glory and to virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Amen. Now, Proverbs chapter 18, verse 24. Proverbs chapter 18, verse 24. A man that has friends must show himself friendly. Don't be a lone ranger. Don't be an isolated person. Look at the children of God. You must have people who are close to you, intimate to you. Show yourself friendly. Let your language show that you are friendly. Let your attitude show that you are friendly. Let your disposition show that you are friendly. You're a friend of Christ, and then these are friends of Christ, and you must be friends with the people of God too, and the blessings of God will overflow in your life in Jesus' name. A man that has friends must show himself friendly, and there is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. Thank God you are not alone. Amen. You'll not be lonely anymore. Amen. I said you'll not be lonely anymore. Amen. Be a friend and benefit from the friendship of the children of God. Let's rise up and talk to the Lord in prayer. Be a friend, be a friend, be a friend. Don't be an enemy, be a friend. Love people, love people. Appreciate people, assist people, bear burdens with people, and care for people, and deliver people from danger at any cost, at every cost. Evangelize, elevate, edify, forgive, forget, set other people free, be faithful, fortify them, grow in giving, help, intercede. Join people who are joyful without compromise. Keep away from corruption. Love, liberate, motivate, move up, neutralize every contention, outgrow old carnalities, persuade other people to continue with the Lord. Quit whatever is contemptible. Reflect Christ. Serve without covetousness. Take converts to the congregation. Uphold with clear conscience, value the holy calling, win with convincing communication, exemplify Christ, yield to correction without contradiction, zero in on conquering with the conqueror, with our captain.